Hi, I'm David.
Hey, David, Bill Goss.
How are you? What's your name?
David, how are you?
David. You're David?
I am. That's an easy one to remember. How are you doing tonight?
Houston, how are you?
Good, good.
Good.
Thanks for coming out.
I'm just for the boss.
Okay.
I don't see you here too often.
No, every once in a blue moon I can show up sometimes. Here and there.
Sheri had to join me?
I'm hiding.
What were you saying?
I'm hiding.
You all right? How's your boy? Is he home? Good deal.
Good to see you.
Doing all right here.
So they're tired.
We're going to have people coming in, you know, late, a little bit later. I know some people have heard that they're going to be running late. The time change has really affected a lot of us. And the weather was a little dreary. I can make a prediction though, it's going to be worse before it gets better. It's 7 o'clock, we've got a full meeting. We want to make sure we have time for enough discussion. So let's go ahead and get started. We'll start as we always do with a prayer, if you would, Pastor Dean.
Father, again, I do thank you very much for allowing me to be here and to be a part of welcoming a couple coming here from Atlanta. Even though they're local, they now work in Atlanta. And we love them, and I miss them both and enjoy them both. Today, Lord, again, I thank you for the tea party I pray that it will continue to be a voice within the Republican Party. And I pray, Lord, that it will be a voice that will be heard around the nation, bringing it back to being a stable government for the people and working with the people. And I thank you, Lord, for they who are part of this group here, because they take a stand and they try to do their best to see that it's one that would be pleasing to you and to the people. Again, I thank you for allowing me to be a part of it. In the precious name of Jesus, the risen Christ our Lord, we do pray.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Take your seats. Pastor, some of you, many of you know him. He's been around for, well, how many years? Tomorrow actually is his birthday.
He's how old? Hello? 85 years? Okay. Oh, always happens. 85 years old. So thank you so much for being here and for being just faithful. And for the prayers you give. Probably need to put it on battery in it. Let me do that. One of the things, if we were to go take a microphone and go to a man on the street thing, one of the things that the average person would have a hard time answering, but I feel like this group will have no trouble answering, is what happened November 11th at 11 o'clock in 1911? 18 was the actual 18. Yeah. We're talking the end of hostilities of World War One. Yeah, and that's the reason we have coming out Veterans Day on a Wednesday. It replaced Armistice Day as the the war actually ended a year later, right? Or sometime next year, sometime next year. But this, the fighting stopped on November 11th. So if we have any veterans here, I'd love for you to at least raise your hand, maybe stand. That's great.
Thank you for coming. And thank you all for coming here. Such a great night. So we're going to go ahead and get started. I've got a lot of things. I'm probably going to forget some stuff, so please don't be upset. Bill Connolly from Kokaly. Bill Kokaly, sorry, from Doug Collins' office. Would like to read something to you about.
Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. It's appropriate that David talked about Veterans Day. Veterans Day is coming up this Wednesday. One of the deepest pleasures that I get to do, and probably the most fun part of my job as a representative of Congressman Collins, is I'm the staffer who gets to put together the academy boards. These are our young men and women who want to serve our nation as officers in the United States military. This year, the Congressman has a crop of young men and women that are absolutely phenomenal. We have 27 young men and women who are applying to become the next generation of our military leaders. They're coming from 11 different counties, including Habersham, Hall, Stevens, Lumpkin, Elbert, Pickens, Fannin, Banks, Gilmer, Jackson, and Forsyth County. I believe we've got three young men and one young woman from Forsyth County who have applied for the service academies. Of those 27, we've got three college students. These are students that are actually in their freshman year in college, and they have decided that they're going to, if they can get into one of the military academies, they will forego all of those credits and start brand new. As freshmen, or as they call them in the academies, plebes, at the service academies. We have six athletes who are part of that, people who are being recruited to play various sports. Now understand, this is not the same as going to UGA as a football scholarship. These people have got to be able to be academically qualified and it's academically challenging at the service academies. We also have two young men who interviewed the previous year. They're coming back a second time, want to get into the academies. And one of the coolest things that's happened is we have got two young men who are coming forward who have a sibling, in this case a sister and a brother, currently at the academy. Last year we had one of the coolest kids I ever met, and then I'll stop right there. She was from Forsyth County. Her name is Cassandra Haller. She came to us and she wanted to become a naval officer. And she came and we talked and she said she wanted to go to the Naval Academy. I said, Cassie, please consider a secondary academy. Please consider a secondary academy. She didn't want to do it. She only wanted to go to the Naval Academy. Between her and her mother, we talked her into it. I'm wrapping it up, Bob. Between the mother and I, we talked her into also seeking a nomination from the Air Force Academy. Got an email last spring. Congressman called her. She had been offered admission to the United States Naval Academy. One week later, she received a call from the United States Air Force Academy. They also wanted her. The cool thing about this young lady is her grandfather graduated from the second class at the United States Air Force Academy. Her mother and her father both graduated from the United States Air Force Academy. Her brother is currently in undergraduate pilot training at Pensacola, Florida, and is a Naval Academy graduate. And she also has a sister who is a current cadet member, a current member of the United States Naval Academy as a cadet. This is the type of young men and women that we have in this 9th District. If you will keep these young men and women in your thoughts and in your prayers, these young men and women have renewed my faith in the next generation. With that, David, thank you very much.
Okay, now we have a lot of little things. Speaking of servicemen, here's a Christmas card. There's a little these little things are on the back there. It's a Christmas card. You can send a Christmas card to a recovering American soldier. It takes none of your time. You know, it's very easy to do, and it means a lot, I'm sure. I don't do nearly enough, but, and certainly the people who are here who served is just, anyway, thank you so much. But we have some giveaways now. We have some flags up here. Did you bring all these flags?
No.
These are for anyone who wants it. If you want to put them out on Wednesday or the day before or any day, that's fantastic. Give them up here, then okay. We also have constitutions. If you're here and don't have a little pocket constitution, Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, the entirety of those documents fits inside your pocket right there. They can't write legislation like that anymore. And we have a raffle. We have two books we're giving away right here.
Everybody get a raffle ticket. Now, I have to be honest with you, I cheated and read both books.
You read. Okay, so if you can't see, we have a Ben Carson's book and we have Donald Trump's book. Why he looks angry?
Yes, they said he did that on purpose.
So okay, well, we're going.
Excellent book.
We're going to pick. Why don't you let the pastor pick since it's his birthday?
Pick one.
You may win. The first winner gets to pick which book they want. That's just the way it's going to have to work.
Last number is 092, the last three numbers. Zero. Choose your book. Now, I will say I have two autographed copies of Ben Carson's. Phenomenal. We got to hear him at the chapel recently.
Yep.
So I'll take Trump just to
balance it out.
Okay. Thank you very much. One more.
Next winner. You know, it's interesting that he's been getting criticism for not being bad enough when he was younger. We had another candidate who wrote a book and nobody...
093.
Wow.
093. Somebody's got to have it.
95.
You got it?
Oh.
Someone's got to have it.
94. Oh, it's so close.
Dig deep, Paul.
I give up.
Okay, we're passing on that one.
You get 95.
Oh, you don't read.
Sorry. No. 102. Oh, 102.
There you go. One last thing, and then we'll get started with the program. We've got a basket. We function through donations. We buy things like this little thing, and we buy constitutions to give away, and t-shirts to march in parades, and the enormous salary that Rob makes. Going paid for advertising and Facebook advertising and signs you see on the side of the road and all the other stuff. So anything you give, dime or nickel or quarter.
Yeah, we promote the new the Forsyth Foods to come and promote this too. That's Kelly Wuttmeyer sitting back there.
I never delivered a paper. I hear this. Okay, so here's what we're gonna do now. Have we done everything? Have I missed anything? We seem to be on track?
Yeah.
Okay. The entire program, the rest of the program, will be taken up by our state representatives up here. Any of you living in this area, they're probably one of your state representatives. We have Representative Gilligan and Senator Williams. And so what I thought we would do is go through a form. I've come up with some sort of ideas. I just had to come up. Bob and I worked together. We met. And Bob actually went to a restaurant and interviewed people and asked them the kind of stuff that they'd be interested in. So we incorporated those and some other ideas, and I sent them ahead of time. This is not a debate. There's nobody they're running against yet, actually, although they're both up for election next year. This is just a way for us to get involved. The session will start in less than 2 months. In January, they're going to be in session. And it's a short session, it's like 40 days, is that right? 40 days and 40 nights. A lot of stuff can happen in 40 days and 40 nights. With that, I've given some sort of ideas I'd like them to do, so let's just get started. And we're actually right on schedule, so that's a remarkable thing. First thing I want to talk about was education. Governor's plan for education, I was reading about that. And here's what we'd like to do. I would like to go through this. I've got sort of a schedule here of times. I'd like to go through the questions that I have, and if some discussion naturally ensues, that's okay. But if you have a question about something or a specific question on the issue, if you could write it down if you're worried about forgetting it, and we'll have a section at the end where we can do it. That way we can get through each one of the sections and come back to the ones here.
Why do you look at me?
You're just there.
I already took care of it for afterwards. Don't worry. We're all good.
Okay. All right, so the governor's, one of the things I read on the governor's plans for education was about teacher salaries. And I didn't actually know this. Right now, you know how salaries are, most salaries for teachers, a lot of it is based on how long they've been at the school. There's a push to make it so that it's based more on merit. So that teachers that are either in disciplines such as science and math, they mentioned those two, or teachers that are doing, their students performing very well and get well high rated, would get better pay, which is something that seems obvious to many of us. The issue comes in because if that plan is implemented, they don't want to increase the total amount of money that's going to be spent for teacher salaries, which would mean that some teachers who are not doing as well would perhaps get pay cut. So there's obviously a lot of people that are upset about that. So I think we'll go ladies first and then the gentleman. So if you could just comment on that, and if you could maybe keep it under a couple of minutes, a minute or two, we'll be okay.
Well, if you don't mind, we may just go back and forth and talk, because we actually did meet a little bit today, just so we could talk about the issues. That, can y'all see if I'm sitting? Because I'm not seeing a whole lot of faces. I like being able to see. So on the education, we met with the Forsyth County Board of Education, the entire Forsyth County delegation. So that's all of the representatives and the state senators came, and we talked with them because, of course, is this not working? Oh, of course. Well, it is. Now? Yes. Now's it working? So we had a great conversation with the Board of Ed, but the subcommittee that has been studying the retention and recruitment of teachers has not yet come out with their final recommendations. So in the consideration was indeed looking at teacher salary. One of the things was to start them at a higher salary and to ramp them up quicker, just to get them to recruit into the teaching field. By the way, if you are currently a teacher in the public schools, it will not affect you unless you wanted to go into this new program. So you could elect to go into the new salary scale, or you could stay in your existing scale. But as he was mentioning right now, the heaviest part of the calculation on how much salary you make in the public school is based on number of years and numbers of degrees. So a person who teaches for 10 years in the PD department and a person who teaches your AP calculus is making the same salary if they have the same degree. And that's not something necessarily good, because when you think about recruiting, the higher level math and science instructors is much harder to get them into that field. So it's something to look at. But like I said, the recommendations have not yet come out on that particular thing. Is there anything you wanted to add?
No, not about that particularly. I think she covered that very well. The underlying point being is that nothing has come out yet. We're still kind of waiting to hear what the study committee has. But there's also lots of different things that's being addressed from the governor's study committee. One of them is the overall funding formula for schools, as well as advancing when you're ready. You know, I assume everybody here's kids are smarter than every other kid. And you know, it's helping your kid to be able to advance whenever they're ready to go, as well as expanding school choice so that you're not stuck with private school, the school that they might be in, that you have options out there to look at your school. So there's a lot of discussion going on there about education. And you also have the Opportunity School District that was passed by both the House and the Senate last session, which is going to be, it's a constitutional amendment, so it'll be on the ballot coming up November 2016. So, and what that does is if the schools are underperforming for 3 years, the state of Georgia will have the right to come in and take over that school district. It will not really affect any school here in Forsyth County. We have really, really good schools. But for other than maybe in the state of Atlanta and stuff like that, if they're failing, the state can come and take over.
Is that by district or by school?
By school.
Okay, the way I heard what you said was by district.
Because it's called the Opportunity District.
It is a school district. So for example, if...
It's a district created out of the bottom 100 schools.
So it's a school. Yeah. So you can pull one school out of a district and then put it into the Opportunity School District so that the state is running. So yes, it is by school. I'm sorry. Correct.
Speaking of school choice, as most of you realize, we have essentially a two-year session in the legislature in Georgia. So it was 2015-2016 is actually sort of a run, and that's why these people are all have a two-year term. Even the senator, United States senators have six-year terms. They don't in the state. You mentioned school choice. One of the bills that I mentioned was a bill that didn't make it past crossover day last year was, I don't remember the House bill number, was the education savings account idea. The idea is the school gets, we'll say $11,000 per student in public school generally to educate a student. And ballpark numbers, half comes from the state, half comes from the county and the federal government. Mostly from the county, not a lot from the federal government. The plan is to allow a very small number of students, perhaps if they're in a public school that is not providing education, that they or their parents will leave, to take some of that, all that state money and put it into a savings account. The school still gets the federal and the county portion of the money, even though there's no one there. But then the parent can use that money to educate this child in a private school, and perhaps, I think, even pay for homeschool expenses. So could you comment on that?
Yeah, that's correct. There was a House bill that Mark Hamilton, who was actually with the rep here, sponsored that.
And, by the way, Dudgeon was second signer.
Yeah, so Hamilton and Dudgeon, second signer. And then I was also a second signer on a bill very similar to that on the Senate side. But there was really not much of an appetite down at the state capitol, primarily because the governor's doing so much stuff right now with education, with opportunity school districts, as well as the study committees. They want to kind of see what bubbles up from that before they address some of these other issues. But
how big of a dent is that going to put in my $10,000 a year tuition payment?
It won't.
Right now? None.
Yeah, right now. So yeah, there was no appetite, but that doesn't mean there's continuing to be no appetite for this kind of thing. One of the things we also mentioned when we got together this afternoon was GOAL, G-O-A-L. That is funded, I believe, at $58 million, and we maxed out in one day. So we'll need to look at seeing if that's the right funding level for that particular thing. GOAL allows individuals and private industry to put money into an account and help people to fund their education that way. So we're looking at education savings accounts, we're looking at changing how much can be collected and put into that GOAL program, because we do want students to have the best opportunity for the best schools.
Yeah, the program is actually the Georgia Education Tax Credit, I think is what it's called. GOAL is actually the biggest provider that they're. The way that works, it's really an amazing thing. You can take, if you owe money to the state and state taxes, and who doesn't, you can take some of that money and direct it instead to a private school, even a Christian school. So the beautiful thing about that, well, the bad thing about that is there's very little money available for it. At first, there was nobody who knew about it, and now people are learning about it. You can actually make money doing this, because you can donate, if you go to a program like GOAL, that nonprofit organization, donate your money to that, write off as a tax credit on your state taxes, which is not a deduction, it's an actual credit, and then you can deduct that from your federal taxes because it's a nonprofit organization. So it's a wonderful thing, and I know a lot of students, you have to have a student who's been in public school and is coming out into a private school, but look into that. Now is the time to get your name in the hat, because they're going to choose at the end of the year, and yeah, we'll run out of stuff very quickly. Anything else you want to say about education real quick before we move on?
No, sir. Say no to Common Core. But we're still
opt out.
Yeah, opt out.
Well, we talked about opt out. I'm sure that will come up at some point. We have a state representative who will tell you that there is no Common Core. He's not in favor of Common Core. And anyway. Okay, moving on. The second topic I had on the list here, and if I had a printer that wasn't running out of ink, I might have printed out more of these, is gambling in Georgia. This is something that's been pushed for a long time. No? Yes? No? No gambling in Georgia? We have a lottery. That's like...
Yeah,
a
lottery is state-sponsored gambling.
Okay, so first one I have, numerical order, House Bill 2 actually came up last year, and it's paramutual betting.
Okay, paramutual betting is the horse tracks and being able to bet there. My going in position is if Kentucky, with a little race called the Derby, is having a hard time keeping their racetracks viable, what does Georgia think it can offer to the horse community that Kentucky can't? So Kentucky is looking at adding casinos to their racetracks called racinos. I mean, there's already a name for them. They're called racinos everywhere else in the country. So Kentucky is looking at doing that. If Kentucky needs to shore up their horse racing, why does Georgia think that they can do it without casino betting? I just don't see the logic. I'm not a big fan.
Yeah, SB2, like you said, was in the Senate last year, and it made it through committee, but it got hung up in rules. And the reason it was hung up in rules was they came up about three or four votes shy for it to pass before they brought it up to the floor. And it's a constitutional amendment, So even if it were to pass House and Senate, it would go to the voters throughout the state to vote to see if they wanted it. And one of the ways that they're trying to sell it to everybody is if this bill passes, if SB 2 passes, it would not straight out legalize horse racing across the state. There would be another referendum. Let's say the city of Atlanta wanted to do some type of horse racing. They would then have to put a referendum on their ballot for Fulton County for them to vote on it to allow horse racing there in Fulton County. So it would require the people to vote on it twice, once as a constitutional amendment, and then a second time if you want it within your county or not. So that's some of the safeguards they're putting in place. But again, it didn't have enough votes last year to pass in the Senate. With it being an election year coming up, I don't see there being enough votes this year either to pass, but we'll know until at the end of session. And as far as casino gambling goes, there has been a lot of talk in the media right now, and there have been some casino moguls come and talk to different state legislators here in the state. But my feeling and my discussion with other Republican senators is you're going to hear more about this in the media than we're actually going to talk about it in the actual state senate. So I don't see that. In fact, I was down at a Republican caucus, a Senate caucus meeting a couple weeks ago, and we just all were very open with each other. We asked, who's going to carry this bill? Nobody raised their hand. So I really don't think there's much of an appetite right now for full-blown casino gambling. And from my perspective, if you want to have a discussion about casino gambling, let's have that discussion about casino gambling. But I am completely against tying casino gambling to trying to save the Hope Scholarship Program. I think those are two completely different issues. And we can tackle the Hope Scholarship problem right now. In fact, Frank Millar, who I know you guys might not like too much, the whole Common Core thing, but he is the chair for higher education. And he and I and several other members of the Higher Education Committee have committed to look into where all this money goes in the Board of Regents and what's happening with all of the Hope Scholarship Fund. So that's definitely something that we're going to look into this next session. But again, I'm completely against tying gambling with the Hope Scholarship.
Second
that. It's going to be, when we talk about, like you say, certainly more in the press because there's a lot of money involved. And they've been trying to get casino gambling and parimutuel betting for a long time here in Georgia.
Well, the way I had it explained to me, they're talking about there would be 5 districts in Georgia, up to 6 casinos. Just as Michael was saying earlier, even if there was an appetite in the House and the Senate for it, it's a constitutional amendment. It requires 2/3 votes there. It being a constitutional amendment also comes out to the folks to vote on it. Then within each one of those districts, before the casino could come in, they would have to do a referendum locally. So it's the same kind of safety net in a way. And I know that there's already the tease that we'll go from 12% to 20% on the taxes, on the revenues. That's interesting, but once again, we are trying to tie that to the Hope Scholarship. Mm-hmm. And I would prefer I send my own child with the savings account that I make, with my education savings account, see? That whole thing that we go full circle. I want to take the ownership for my child's education and not do it through the Hope account in the first place. By the way, I'm also that parent who didn't share my child's Social Security number with the school. And if you don't share that information with the school, you're not eligible for HOPE. Did you know that?
You can share it later on, though. Yeah. If you share it when they're in high school, then you're eligible for HOPE.
Yeah, you can do it when they go to college, even. But I was not going to. Mm-hmm.
They are connected. Their vote's already connected to the DMV, so they have it once they turn 15 anyway.
Okay. There you go.
She mentioned 20%. We're talking about money. I discovered this also in preparing this. The casinos really want this to happen. And so they are offering, they said, well, okay, how about if we pay 20% state taxes? And you know how you see the state going, wow, what? That sounds pretty good now. But it looks like they aren't buying, so that would be good. A point of privilege. Wait, you want to ask real quick?
I just want to make a comment that Jim and I were involved in fighting the lottery back in, 1990? Yeah. And a bunch of legislators down there waffled out on it and voted for it because they were not voting for it, they were voting for the people to have the voice. Well, all the money, no matter how many double safeguards you've gotten this, all the money is on one side of this. And for citizens to come up with opposition money and opposition organization is extremely difficult when you're up against these multi-billion dollar enterprises. And so there, it's not a level playing field. The citizens are
campaigning whenever it goes to people for a vote, the advertisements, the campaign,
oh,
the other side.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Unlimited funds to get it passed.
Yeah, $1 billion investment. So, if you have $1 billion investment, you are definitely going to bring in
people. Right. But that, I would hope neither of you and none of your friends would give us this stuff about, well, I'm against it personally, but I think the people should decide. Because the people get only one side of the story.
If I can kind of ask a question about, because I hear that a lot.
You hear what?
About, well, you're just allowing the people to vote, and I think the people need to vote in that. Is there anything that you would prefer to have the vote on and not us? For example, you don't want gambling to come to the people. You want us to stop it. Yeah. Is there something that you would not want us to stop and allow to come to the people for a vote? Kind of the opposite side of that coin. Is there anything that you guys can think of?
Like term limits?
Yeah. So
a constitutional amendment to do term limits.
That's already passed. So that Georgia was the first state to vote in favor of a constitutional amendment.
For term limits?
That's going to be one of the top.
You're talking about a convention of states, but like Lamar or.
Yeah, I'm talking at state level, there's no term limits on you guys.
Yeah. No, there's not.
I don't know if there's been movement since the last Tea Party I came to, but the pastor of the Religious Protection Act.
Okay.
Yeah, that's coming out. It's on the agenda. Oh, definitely. Yeah.
Excellent. Your plan.
It's my plan. Actually, that's
our next topic. So for through gambling, moving on, you mentioned the finding. I just recently had an issue that I was against, and you know, our little group was against, and Chamber of Commerce was in for, and they raised $150,000 to spend. So, you know, like it's gonna, they can do the marketing and the advertising for it. Religious liberty, then. We'll move on to that. And like I said, we save a question for this, and I'm sure we'll come up with a discussion at the end. We'll probably leave a lot of time at the end. One of the bills that I discovered that is not yet a real, point of privilege, a side note, we mentioned a 2-year session. Legislation is introduced. If it's introduced in the first year and it doesn't pass, it's not dead. If it gets through one house, it's still alive. It can go through the other one. Senate Bill 2, the parimutuel betting one, it's still alive.
Still alive, yeah.
And several others are too. And so is the education savings account legislation. Casino gambling has not been introduced yet.
Not yet.
Okay. So if let's say that, the education savings account fails, this year, can it be reintroduced again? Can they keep doing that?
Okay.
Yep, it can be introduced many times if there's a senator or representative that want to bring it up.
So it's probably easier to get half your work done 1 year and then maybe the next half of next year. I don't know. Maybe you lose momentum. Who knows?
Well, I mean, in 40 days, there's a lot going on in that 40 days. And so, you know, at least you have 2 years to get something, like you say, worked and planned.
Yeah.
And I'm speaking from my vast experience.
No, how many of you have been down to the Capitol during the legislative session? Most of us have. Thank goodness you've been there. Okay, religious liberty. One of the things I discovered is Speaker Ralston is looking, I've heard, going to introduce this thing called the Pastor Protection Act. And I first saw that, I thought, wow, let's look into that. The idea is a pastor of a church that does not recognize same-sex marriage, for instance, won't have to perform same-sex marriages. And I thought, well, that seems like a good thing to do. But then I heard, and I don't know if this is true or not, that you mentioned RFRA, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, which is very unpopular with Chamber of Commerce, the Georgia Chamber of Commerce, very unpopular with Delta Airlines. Big companies, big campaign donors are not happy with RFRA. I heard the rumor that this idea of coming out with the Pastor Freedom Act or the Pastor Protection Act, which everybody would get behind, why would you, who would force a pastor to marry somebody that doesn't want to marry? Then the speaker can say, well, we've done our religious thing for the year, we aren't going to touch RFRA. That one's, RFRA's still alive. Joshua Cumming sponsored that one. And
that actually passed the Senate, so
it handily, right?
Yeah, it did. And the SB 129, which is the RIF for the state of Georgia, I think there's maybe a handful of votes against it, but it passed, and it's sitting in the Judicial Committee on the House side right now.
Well, could you kind of back up and give us a little running thing, whichever you knows it better, about what it is, why it's needed, and your thoughts on whether this Pastor Protection Act is sort of a plan to keep that from even being brought up again.
One of the more interesting things that I learned about RFRA was that it was passed during Bill Clinton's administration. At a federal level. So nearly the same bill was passed by President Clinton.
Do you know who signed it or who sponsored it? Okay. Chuck Schumer.
Well, of course.
I mean, think about it. If you're wanting to talk about conservatives, would you have said Chuck Schumer and Bill Clinton?
No. In the U.S. House, nobody voted against it. It was passed unanimously. In the U.S. Senate, only one senator voted against it. So just 15 or so years ago, it was across the board support. Now all of a sudden, it's discriminatory, it's this, it allows people to break the law underneath a religious context, which is just a bunch of... It doesn't allow for anybody to beat their kids or anything like that. It just protects those that have a conviction or belief to exercise it. And it prevents the government from coming in and stopping you from doing that. It does not have anything to do with individual businesses. Nothing whatsoever.
And some people think, well, if you have the federal RFRA, why do you need it at the state level? When this started out at the federal level, it was to guarantee that the government could not compel you to break your convictions, your religious convictions. Then there was a case, I forget the year, I forget the name, and I will, if you contact me, I'll look that up for you. But there was a case, and guess what? The Supreme Court decided that the states had a right, and therefore the state could indeed compel someone to break their convictions, their religious convictions. So already there are over 30 states who have something akin to the federal RFRA. South Carolina is one of those states. So when people say that we will lose business, I just keep remembering South Carolina already has this on the books. And where did Volvo go?
Where did Boeing go?
I keep thinking, is it really so bad for business if South Carolina already has this? And Mike showed me a map today. I'm sorry, Michael. Senator William showed me a map today.
I know, it's when your friends first,
yeah. It's like, oh, sorry, I forget the protocol. But when Senator Williams showed me a map today, Georgia and North Carolina, right, were the only states in the entire eastern or southern swath that do not yet have a RFRA law on the books. And ours is almost verbatim, the federal RFRA law. But it will say that the state, see, it doesn't like me, the state cannot force you to break your religious convictions unless there is a compelling need. And it's the same judicial prudence that goes, it's been on the books forever, that compelling need. Yes, ma'am.
How does RFRA work with Sharia law? Because I know that has been a problem for you.
Once again, they can't force you to go against your religious convictions, but if your Sharia law says that you can stone your daughter who has done something, your common law will still come in. So there's nothing that says I can commit murder or I can commit harm, I can do child abuse, I can do any of those. All those other protections would still be in place. But it's that other, reason to force you to do something against your religious convictions. The state cannot do that unless there's a compelling need to do it. Yes?
I just have a question, maybe to educate me more than anyone else here. How is it that Sharia law has any kind of play as any kind of law in the United States. I don't understand that. How do we allow that in this country, period? Just because there's a population of people that come in and say all of a sudden we need to have Sharia law? Well, no, that never existed here before. So then we had the Constitution, now we have to have something else beside that, and we have to tolerate that? I don't understand that. Because there are some places that are allowing that.
Not in Georgia.
Well, no.
That's all I'm talking about right now. Here in Georgia, that does not apply. We have our laws and she'll have to.
Michael, in answer to your question or statement, I think part of the problem has become the social morality of the American society and this commonness of feeling good to make people become part of America, but they don't assimilate anymore. Back when everyone was coming into the island in New York, they didn't get off of there until they learned this. Well, they were off the island, but they didn't become citizens until they learned the language. They had to understand the Constitution. There were things that they wanted to assimilate. That's no longer the case. They come in, like you're talking about, they form little communities, and they transplant their country to use our economy.
Why don't they go back where they came from?
Good idea.
Because they get so much stuff for free.
Yeah. Well, before we kind of got digress, again, we're state, we can't, the most of that stuff is going to be federal. That's kind of out of our control. But right, the congressman get involved.
Just point out, there are a lot of states that are passing only American laws in American courts. Georgia has not passed that type of law. So if we are citizens that believe in the Constitution and that America law should be practiced in American courts and institutions only, why can't the state of Georgia, like I believe 28 other states have done that?
We can.
I know that there has been, David Morris has been trying to get the Georgia law for Georgia courts. I don't know the history of where that is. If there's not been a sponsor, if there's not been a bill drafted, I don't know. So I would have to do some research for involved to find out.
We want you to be our sponsors, the two of you.
But is that something at least you would support?
Oh, definitely. Yeah.
The ALAC, American Law for American Courts, is the one we're talking about. And it's interesting, I'd like to think it's because I planned this thing so well, but the next topic I have here is federal overreach and
state. Well, before we move on, you mentioned the Pasture Protection Act, and we've also talked about the RFRA. There's a third bill that's out there that's being discussed as well, and that is the First Amendment Defense Act. And what that is, as Sheri talked about with RFRA, the government will not intervene on your religious belief unless there's a compelling interest. If there's a compelling interest, then the state will have the right to do that. What the First Amendment Defense Act, it's limited in scope, not to your entire religious belief, but in regards to homosexuality and gender identity. If you have a professed belief in either one of those, no matter what, the state cannot come and intervene. So it gives you more protection, but it's more narrowly scoped. So there's a lot of people that's talking about that as well as the Pasture Protection Act. So there's three different bills right now that's kind of being floated around.
You mentioned a term, compelling interest. Yeah. That sounds subjective. Can you define what a compelling interest is and who decides what a compelling interest is?
I cannot personally define it, but I do know that that has been a court precedent, just like we used to have common court or common law. So it's one of those definitions that's out there, and if I had a legal expert in the room, they would be able to define it to me, and I'm not one.
Just any kind of an idea.
Just a broad definition, it's the most compelling argument that the state has to come on, how do I say this?
It's the highest bar.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. It's just the highest level.
High standard that
the state has to come in and improve their case almost beyond a shadow of a doubt. This is why. So it's the highest.
What enters my mind is an initial thing.
Right.
Okay. So like somebody can have their stuff taken because there's a compelling interest. Now, I may not agree with that. Maybe the people would, if they were to vote on something like that, would also agree with me. So I just don't understand this term of compelling interest is and who defines that subjective term. I'd like to see a black and white somewhere, so I understand it myself.
Lawyers define it.
Seems like the county's doing it.
All right, so that's a tell-in.
Okay. Getting into state sovereignty, so this may elicit a lot of discussion here, which is fine, because we're doing absolutely fine with time. One of the issues that I've heard people be very involved with is refugee resettlement. Now, I don't know the numbers. The numbers of this are difficult to get. There's a lot. I've been trying to find, like, how many illegal aliens are in our public school system. You can't get that information. They will collect race statistics, they'll collect everything, but they won't collect that, and they clearly choose not to do that. The same thing here, it's more difficult to, the federal government, though, is forcing states around the country to accept refugees, mainly from Middle East areas, to come here, and they give them money for, I think, 90 days, I think that's the way the program works, federal funding. After that, though, is a state responsibility. The idea was when the economy is moving, they can get out, get a job, and become a productive member of each state. That's not working right now. So these people are becoming dependent on the state. And over Gwinnett County, where I'm from, huge taker. DeKalb County, I think, is a big one. Fulton's probably a big one. And Forsyth has a few. Can you speak a little bit on the idea of refugee resettlement? And I know that there's people trying to get the state to say, it's a federal issue again, but the state could strongly request that we at least stop resettlement in Georgia.
I personally do not like the idea of taking in refugees to our country. I was reading an article where there's a movement on the national level, instead of bringing in refugees to our country, to creating safe zones in their own country, wherever they might be coming from, for example, in Syria or whatnot, and for us to help in creating a safe zone so they can stay in their country, and then once things calm down, they can go back to where they came from. That is the answer for me, is to keep them there, help them to stabilize their area instead of bringing them over here. So
that, and there is the draw of the dollar, so the federal government tempts you with the money to take the refugees. So there's that draw, oh, I'll get some money if I take the refugees. So there's that carrot. But one thing you have to understand, the people who come in as refugees are automatically put onto the list to become American citizens. So they are already on the track to become American citizens. So it's something for us to really think about in how
that's how
the law is written.
I
didn't say it. I liked it. But I am letting you know that that's how it's written right now.
Along those lines, we have a lot of illegal aliens in Georgia, and that's been addressed on or tried to be addressed in sessions past. Do you know of any movement in that? I know that right now there's some things. Georgia's getting driver's license to certain statuses of illegal aliens, which is concerning to a lot of us. Another thing that's do you have any comments on that or what might be happening?
Yeah, there is a bill right now in the Senate called SB6, which would prevent the Department of Driving Services to issue driver's license unless you are a citizen or a documented immigrant. That has not made it out of committee, and it doesn't. Unfortunately, there's not a lot of appetite right now in the Senate to address that. So I don't foresee in the near future that coming out of committee, but it is one there, and it's something that I'm a co-sponsor of as well. For me, I actually invited several of the DECA kids into my office to kind of sit down and talk to them, figure out what their perspective was. And the question that I kind of asked them was, I think it was November of last year is when Obama signed the executive order. So before that happened, they could not get a license here in Georgia. Mm-hmm. Once the President of the United States signed an executive order, he then now forced us here in Georgia to issue license. Mm-hmm. I just fundamentally, to me, that's wrong. Mm-hmm. It bypassed the entire legislative process and executive process. And if we want to go down that route, let's go down that route and do it the right way. But just having one person sign an executive order that makes us here in Georgia issue licenses, I'm against.
Yeah, the real elephant in the room isn't licenses for illegal aliens. The real elephant
there's
in the
lots
room
of, yeah, there's lots
is to steal the election in 2016. California has already made it legal, if not look the other way, for millions of illegal aliens to have driver's license and vote in the state of California. That's going to happen all over the United States. So really, I really wish the debate would be not about driver's licenses, but I wish that you and in the elected positions you are would talk about the theft of the 2016 elections as being the real object of the Democratic Party.
Okay. So would this then be a 10th Amendment issue? So he signs an executive order.
Okay. Okay.
Big whoop. Now the 10th Amendment kicks in, you tell him to go to hell.
Can't you disobey?
Yeah.
I mean, can't
what's going on with this?
Can't you use the 10th Amendment power to just tell them, no, we're not
doing that? You can to a certain degree. This is, let's kind of back up a little bit. I'm of the opinion right now that the Constitution of the United States of America is no longer in play. Not that it shouldn't be, because it should be, but it's not. Just look at the last ruling about gay marriage. Nowhere in our Constitution is marriage a constitutional right. But they said it was. So, while I believe in the Constitution and I feel the 10th Amendment completely applies, it doesn't work right now. And until we can take over the White House, until we can kind of what Bob talked about, we have to change the direction our country is going.
Okay.
Because right now it's just
a con, constitutional convention, the states are there.
Georgia has, there's three different options for a convention of the states, and Georgia's passed all three. So if we can get the other states to do it, Georgia will be right there.
So then what's stopping the con from happening?
We don't have enough states.
It's not a con, it's different than a con, convention of states.
Oh.
But this is an interesting thing, because we have heard, you know, in speaking what some of the people are saying, we heard a number of years ago, and when the Democrats control the federal level, House, Senate, and executive branch. So like, if only we had the House, we could get something done. So whatever. We don't have the Senate. We can't get it.
We got the Senate.
Well, you guys feel the frustration.
If I can kind of take a point of personal privilege right here. I am the state co-chair for the Donald Trump campaign. And whatever you think about Donald Trump, if you like him or you don't like him, in my mind, he is the only candidate that has the you-know-what to change the direction in which our country is going. Any other candidate on that stage that you might support, you can support, you can believe in. I think any one of them would be better than the alternative. But they're all going to be tied to certain class of people, to their supporters. Donald Trump is not accepting funds. He's not going, let me rephrase that. He's not campaigning for funds. He's not asking for funds. If you want to donate money to me, you can send him a check and cash it. But he's not out there asking for funds, because he's going to do it on his own. And that is why, that's one of the biggest reasons I'm supporting him, is because he's not tied to anybody.
No lobbyists, nothing.
And then he can make the decisions. We have to make some pretty tough decisions, really tough decisions in this country. And he's had to make them before.
Okay, so he does his little stump speech. Anybody here familiar with the Heritage Foundation?
Yeah.
Okay. Please look at the scorecard. They rated all of the presidential candidates on the Republican side. If you would take a moment to look at that, you will see that the one that bubbles up to the top is actually Senator Ted Cruz. The one that came in second for Senator Cruz was actually Senator Rand Paul. Donald Trump did not fare quite well in the Heritage Foundation.
Like
now, but there are six metrics that they were using, so go look at that, if you will, and that way, I'm not going to try to sway you one way or another, not tonight anyway. I mean, later.
But not tonight.
I'll try to sway you. Yes, sir? Oh, Dr. B.
Just this morning, I contacted every one of the offices in Washington of our congressmen. My whole reason for calling them was I wanted them to pass on to those particular congressmen, both the Senate and the House, to gather together and bring traitor treason case against, of all people, our own president.
Okay, did y'all hear what he said? He wanted to bring up treasonous charges against President Obama.
Yeah, why stop there?
At least start.
Okay, coming issue, we're going to get back on track for state issues. We'll have time at the end if you want to come back around this. One of the things I find about people who, as they get more and more wonky, as you guys get more and more down there, they'll use terms sometimes and undefined. And he mentions DACA, which is something that the Obama administration did to mainly they call them dreamers. It's deferred action of childhood arrivals. So children that came here, even though they're illegal in the country, when they're children, they went through the group, the schools, and so they have now been given the option to not be deported. That's what deferred action means. And also receive driver's license. The next push coming out of executive office is something called DAPA, which is Deferred Actions for Parents of Americans. So if you came over here, if you came over here illegally and had a child in the United States who was an American citizen, then now you will qualify under deferred action and driver's license. So you see exactly where that's, That's the way, one of the things that this, Bob Fry, by the way, he works for the Tea Party. I'm David Hancock. I don't want to ever introduce myself. One of the things that we discuss frequently is our side, the conservative side, has a tendency of, you do it my way, I'm taking my mom and going home. And the other side doesn't. The other side is very persistent and very, over years, they make a little step here and a little step there.
May I make one other comment? We did mention the fact that when the Democrats had the House and the Senate and the White House, that they got a lot of things accomplished. Please understand, we have a Republican majority that does not equate to a conservative majority. Yes. So please understand that. So when the Democrats went into lockstep, they absolutely grabbed arms and just lockstep. We don't do that, and we are far more independently minded.
Circling back to the question, you mentioned two laws, one existing, one's being proposed for illegal aliens. Could you, if you're familiar with the connection between what you just mentioned and the potential, either existing or potential, electoral fraud on a national scale, you gentlemen have examined that. Would you please bring it up? Because that's what really the object is electoral fraud.
Doesn't that fall under the Secretary of State? How do they qualify these people?
And I'm talking about the national level. Yeah. It's being attempted by the Democratic Party in 2016 is to use all these illegal aliens. All right, to cast the deciding votes in favor of the Democratic Party, period. And so would you, either of you like to talk about that?
I don't even know where I
am. Are you familiar with it?
No, I don't know what my particular action can be, what I can do physically to take action.
Is he saying that they're gerrymandering with the illegals?
No, there are many states that are not going to check IDs. California, they want.
It's the same, the fact that you can walk in, register, and vote the same day. You know, so stealing elections. And every state has different ways of doing elections. And yes, it's a big, big concern. And still in my position, I have no clue what my option is to make a fair and open election. And I wish I could tell you better that I could make it happen.
Well, couldn't Georgia address this on state by state, at least?
Because you have active models in place. California's model legislation, which was signed into law by a Jerry Brown. You have an example of what the law looks like that let them steal the election. So if you have a state that's showing you how to steal an election, why don't you write a law that shows you how not to steal an election and have it written in Georgia? Just pick it up, copy it, and write the word no next to it.
I tell you something that we would, I'm speaking mainly for myself, and if you guys want to back me up, that'd be great. You two, you know, you're a senator, state senator. That's a big deal. There aren't many of you. She's a state representative. There are a lot more state representatives, and you're known here in this area by the very people in this room, certainly. But you get down to Gainesville, or you get down to Macon, and pretty soon you guys aren't known, and then you get to Alabama. And I would love for both of you to become people that in Pennsylvania they say, Sheri Gilligan in Georgia. Man, you know, we would get behind you. We would support you. We would back you if you were willing to stand up and do the Donald Trump thing. I mean, I'm not a supporter of Donald Trump, but I'm not saying saying I'm not a supporter, but that would just be to make a name for your, not for yourself, but to make a name for liberty. Right.
Absolutely. We have some legislation that I'll have to do now.
And by the way, I'm going to go one more time back to the driver's license. Everybody in this room, when you renew your license, what'd you have to take with you?
Birth certificate.
Okay, all that stuff. And if you're a married woman and you've ever had a previous marriage, you know, the fact that you have a different name than what was on your birth certificate.
When you take the marriage license.
Yes. So all of that I have to take, do you think it torques me to no end that somebody who is not here legally can just walk in and get that without having to prove who they are and why they're here? So yeah, this is something that's, okay, it's gonna be personal. Some of these laws are gonna be very personal. So yeah, we're going to do what we can as effectively as we can, pushing everybody in one direction.
It's just been described as herding cats down there at the Capitol, it is a mess. But kind of going to the 10th Amendment, one more issue on that is, there is legislation being talked about on the Senate to sue the federal government on some of these EPA regulations that they're pushing down. So I don't, I mean, my comments, I don't want you to feel like we're not doing anything, because we are doing some things. It's just we don't have that foundation, the Constitution that we had in the past to rely on it as a rock, because it's been eroded. But we have intentions to sue the federal government over the EPA regulations and exercise that intent.
Well, how about we succeed then?
We did that once.
Yeah, I actually have a better idea. Why don't we just stop accepting federal money and tell them to keep it so they don't bribe you or try to bribe every other elected official under the gold dome, including the executive branch, to do it the federal government wants. Because it's one thing to say we need to have it stop, but it's really hard to keep a straight face when your pockets are full of federal money. So I really would appreciate it if the state of Georgia would tell the federal government to stop it.
And that conversation is actually taking place. They are looking at it seriously. I know it doesn't seem like they are, but it is in serious conversations down there. But you have to figure out, of course, if you say we won't take the money, how do you handle the budgetary offset?
Well, limited government as a Republican, you chop government to nothing.
Well, but you see what I'm saying? Yeah, what can we do realistically? Right. How can we do it? And how many people in this room are willing to have their own personal taxes go up again, knowing that you're still going to have all those taxes going to the federal government that are not coming back to you?
Yeah, but that's their problem. We did not create that.
Well, but
we have to send
it. It's a short.
In Georgia have to.
No, actually, the elected representatives made the mess. You clean it up.
Well,
we will do our best. But again,
if you think we can do it in 1 year, yes.
I hope I've got this correct and not screwed up, but one of the controversial things in the last session was the gasoline excise tax. And one of the reasons they did that, the way they did it, was because in the past, the transportation taxes or the T-splash taxes were not mandated that they had to stay for transportation. They went into the general fund and God knows where the money went. So the new tax was set up to be adhered to the Georgia Constitution, which says, since it's an excise tax, it has to be used for transportation. Now, that was a correction, I think, which was very good, but there were a lot of conservative people that were really very aggravated with that particular
tax. And also, Bob, one step further, it did exactly what you're talking about. Yeah. One of the reasons we raised the gas tax was so that we don't have to accept as much federal money. And you know how many Tea Party people cussed me out because I did that?
Yeah.
You can talk all day long about cutting off the funds from the federal government, but right now it's just not going to happen. We can take, like he said, baby steps to try to get there, but if we right now we spend about $42-44 billion in the state of Georgia. 22 comes from you guys. The rest comes from the state of Georgia. You guys want your taxes doubled overnight.
I'm hearing
Bob, you want me to vote to increase your taxes?
I've been hearing this since I voted for Reagan.
I get it. It's tough. We are in a tough situation right now. There are no easy answers. And it's going to take all of us working together. Not just finger pointing, saying, do this, do that. We've got to come together. We've got to come up with a plan. And we've got to fight against them, not amongst ourselves.
You're absolutely right, and, okay, but it's all, it's always the federal dangling of the carrot. It's just like, and I'm beating a dead horse, most of you know who I am, but race to the top, okay? We got $450 million for that.
How many here knows your Board of Education takes federal money? Your Board of Education?
Yeah.
Okay, so again, it's not just one group of elected officials.
At the same time, how many people here know that your Board of Education doesn't represent you, even though you elect them?
Right.
Yeah. And then again, okay, so, yeah, so we take the money without knowing that it's going to cost us another $650 million to fully implement this. Right. I mean, so you can keep taking the carrot as long as you know the repercussions on the other side.
But one more thing. Yeah. Do you guys know what filled my inbox the most this past legislative session? Take a wild guess.
Spam.
Bus drivers not getting insurance. I got more emails about the bus drivers, possibility of bus drivers losing their insurance.
Do you know why Richard Woods won by 30,000 more votes on the fifth page of the ballot than the Governor Beal did?
No.
It's the same group. It's the teachers.
Okay.
If we don't have a voice in this state.
And if you don't take federal money, how are these teachers going to keep the salaries they have?
I mean, it's a web that has been woven, it's going to take a long time.
Okay,
I'm going to cut this off myself. The United States of America has a big cancer that is pulling it down, and it's not just education. You're on a specific issue that is a problem, but there are massive problems that have to be solved. The number one thing we have to do is win the presidency. I don't care how we win it, we need it.
True.
If you want to turn any of this stuff back and correct education, which is a long-term project, we got to get rid of the social cancer that is destroying this country.
What happened at the 2014 midterms? I mean, we literally swept.
You want me to tell you my personal
dominated, opinion? And then the Republicans turned socialist overnight.
Yeah.
Well. Republicans, the Tea Party, actually was a major part of that loss. And what they did was there was a whole section of the Tea Party on a nationwide basis that supported Paul. And once he did the way he was treated by the Republican Party at the convention, they threw up their arms and said, we're going to go home and not vote. And they didn't. And we know there were probably, I don't know how many millions of them that stayed home. So you can't blame that particular problem.
I'm making the statement in 2014, Republicans were elected.
Oh, I'm sorry, I thought you wanted
No, I'm talking about 2014. The midterms were great. We elected a lot more Republicans.
Yeah.
We thought we had the ball. And what did they do? They threw the ball to the Democrats.
We still have a president that moves things around unconstitutionally. So you just cannot blame the Senate and the House.
Well, we voted and we...
Okay, as much as everyone here is really angry at Washington, D.C., we're going to turn our focus again to what's going on in Atlanta. We have problems down there that we will absolutely do our level best. I agree. We do not have conservative majorities, even though we have Republican majorities, and we are going to do our absolute level best. We do need you to stay with us and stick with us. Keep in touch with us. By the way, I'm going to be really rude, point of privilege here. This is to get on my email list. Michael didn't bring one, so if you would like to get on his list, just we can share it. So if it's okay, I will just give all of these emails directly to Senator Williams. But I intend to send legislative updates so that you know what's going on down at the Capitol. But when you get information, scream at us, but don't hit me, okay? I grew up with brothers, so I don't really want to get that much damage, but be reasonable with me, disagree with me, have a great discussion with me, agree with me, whatever it is, but let's keep working forward to make something great happen, because that's our key, and that's what we want to do. And Paul, I'm going to go to him and see if he wants to continue the conversation. Okay, is that fair?
No, that's David.
I know, but I was telling Paul I'm going to go to David.
Oh, I see. I was confused.
No, he had his hand up, and I didn't know if you wanted to.
No. Go ahead. Yeah.
Alternative currencies in Georgia would be an idea that could help us out. Like Ithaca has the Ithaca dollars. It's something to think about. There's a lot of grassroots.
Georgia dollar?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, really, there's a lot of grassroots things that we can do maybe where we can.
Do you own Bitcoin?
Cryptocurrency itself is an excellent idea. Do you have to be careful?
Do you own any Bitcoin?
Personally, I do not. But cryptocurrency as a platform for anonymous voting and also for being able to make sure that the votes aren't stolen and you have a one person for one vote as another system, it could be used. Cryptocurrency is a revolutionary changing technology and it will eventually subvert a lot of the existing power status quo if it's understood by the masses and implemented properly.
Okay, so moving back to say a couple of things to keep in mind. One thing, Representative Gilligan here, her name tag is probably still wet. I mean, she's I don't mean that in a bad way, but until you become like Senator Renee Hunter, and my senator, who can probably get a lot of stuff done, it's hard. It's hard. So, you know, and there's a huge point in their favor. They're both here tonight, and they both come regularly. I see them here frequently. So. This is what you need. You need representatives who are willing to come and stand for you. And if they make a mistake, don't listen to it. And you may have something wrong. You may misunderstand something and they may have to clear it out. Some other issues we talked about, one of the things that I had listed on there, state representatives being able to build a warehouse, speaking with Buzz Rockaway a couple of weeks ago. And we're talking about campus carry for handguns. And one of the things that he was told in that meeting was that that means that women on campus can't even carry pepper spray or mace. And he didn't realize that. And I understand someone from that group called you both and mentioned that to you. Do you know of any legislation to correct that?
I did get an email about that, and I'll be honest, I have not done the research yet to prove that you can or cannot carry pepper spray or mace. I know that when I was a student at the University of Georgia 1,000 years ago, that we actually had defense classes, and they were always talking about the different kinds of sprays that you could use, and they would demonstrate them so that you could see which one really worked well. Mm-hmm. That one shoots at a distance, that's a really good one. we're both very much interested in finding out first the veracity of that statement, and then if indeed you can't even carry something like that, okay, I am not a big proponent of the rape whistle. like I said, I was at the University of Georgia, and there was one particular time that I was walking on campus without having asked for a guard to escort me. And I was scared, absolutely spitless. And I made sure that I had my spray from that moment on in my hand. I was very fortunate. He was too drunk to accomplish it. But that was a scary, scary moment for me. But as we were talking today, I made the comment that as an American citizen, I believe that my I believe that my rights do not stop at my front porch. Therefore, my First Amendment right to say or pray anything at any time follows me wherever I go in the United States. That's all 50 states and the District of Columbia. I believe that my Second Amendment rights should follow that same pattern. It doesn't stop at my front porch door. And that's the way I look at things. All of those other rights carry over, but the First and the Second are always under debate in the states, and I don't understand that now. So that's something that I would like to see really addressed.
Yeah, I agree. If in fact that is accurate, then I have no objection at all to allowing people to carry mace and other protection devices on campus.
You know what, actually, I had a sheriff's department person tell me one time that wasp spray is actually incredibly effective and it's long range. Mm-hmm. Just throwing that out there. Yes, wait, I have something to say real quick. I'd like to thank Nydia Tisdale for being here and videotaping this. She does this at her own expense. I knew I would miss something. And she's always in the background. She never interrupts. She never says anything. So I'd like to thank her very much for being here and say that she has a little table here with a flower and a little jar. If you want to put like a dollar or something in there or a $100 or whatever you feel bad. It would be great if she does it. She goes around the state. She is just tremendous at just documenting what people say. She gets a lot of bad press because sometimes people don't want what they say to be available to the public, and that's something that we need to fix. I think transparency is a big benefit. So she's also got some books from the Attorney General about how to do freedom of information requests and the like. So those are very helpful.
I actually did have two.
Can I say something?
I had two topics that I'd like to have addressed, and that's Sheri Springs, and the second topic having the commissioners voted by the entire
at large,
rather than by district. Thank you.
Well, the city of Sheri Springs. Who's here has heard about the proposed city of Sheri Springs? Almost everybody. Who here supports the creation of a new city in Forsyth County?
Who here lives in the proposed area of Sheri Springs? So the only person who would have a voice on the ballot.
There's a bill currently that Mike Judge and the rep down there has introduced into the House that would create this new city. And right now, it's going under the guise of what's called a city light. So it would be a complete full-blown city. There's three services that they would provide. And what they're looking at is zoning, code enforcement, and trash. And the Carl Vinson Institute did a study. It was a feasibility study to look at how much money it would require, when it would come from, and all that. And it came back really positive. And there is a huge movement down the south part of the county to form their own city. It's not an easy task, though, particularly right now on the Senate side. They're doing a study committee looking at the whole process of forming a city. They're looking at the constitutionality of something called the city light. And there's a lot of discussion going on around that. So with that going on, in conjunction with just a lot of personality issues. What I mean by that is there was another city, the city of South Fulton. Almost all of Fulton County is incorporated, except a very small portion of it down the south part of their county. And they wanted to incorporate. The bill made it from the House, made the House committee, went to the floor, the House was voted and passed, came to the Senate, made it to the Senate committee, and was about to go to the floor of the Senate. Another senator that had some type of vendetta against the senator that was carrying on the Senate side pulled the bill. Had nothing to do whatsoever with the concept or the idea of the South Fulton. It was just a personal issue. So whether we like to admit it or not, there is a lot of personal vendetta stuff going on down there. And so it's got to get through the House, the Senate, and then eventually be voted on by the people who would live in the incorporated part of the county, or of the city. So that's kind of the process that goes through and where we are with it. Is that
commissioners? And then the second question.
Can I say something about that?
Sure.
So this is what happens. They become a city. They have the three little things going on. Then all of a sudden, well, the cops didn't get here fast enough. Well, we didn't get the fire department here fast enough. Oh, now we want a cop. We want more cops and more fire. That's what's going to happen.
There is discussion about that. Mike Dungeon has incorporated what's called a millage cap that says that the city will not raise the millage rates any higher than this cap unless it goes to referendum for the people to vote on. So that's kind of the perceived mechanism for keeping it a more smaller city. But you're right, there's nothing that prevents it from turning to a full-blown city.
Thank you for that, Senator. Did I understand you to say that they're studying the constitutionality of city lights?
Yes.
Yeah.
Because we've already got at least one city light that I'm aware of.
There's a couple.
And just to clarify what that means, every city in the state of Georgia can provide a certain number of services. And it's a big, long list of services. But a city, to maintain its incorporation, must provide three, no less than. And then you can pick and choose those three. So there are cities in the state of Georgia that do indeed only do the three. However, if that city council wanted to increase the number of services, they can just vote in a council meeting to go ahead and decide to add that. A city light is requiring that the city council, yes, they can vote that they want to add another service, but it has to go to a referendum to the citizens, to the voters, to decide whether or not, yes, indeed, we want more fire, or we want more police, or we want whatever. So that's the part that they are saying, well, gee, the city, by definition, can serve or provide all these services, why are you saying that there must be a referendum? So that's the part that is perhaps being debated, or it's not perhaps, it is being debated. And there are opinions on both sides of that. That it is or it isn't, I don't know, there is not been a case, so we don't know. But that's the idea, that those three services that Sharon Springs is talking about, which is code enforcement, planning, zoning, and trash. So those would be the three, and then if it wanted to provide any other service, it would have to do a referendum to go before the voters, and the voters would have a say whether or not they want to pay for that.
I think they'll be full-blown in 2 years. Full-blown
in 2 years. Can I change the subject a little bit?
What about the commissioners?
For the county commissioners, I spent a lot of time this past session looking into the possibility of going back to at-large countywide voting for county commissioners. And what I ran into was something called the Civil Rights Act of 1964, Section 2, which pretty much prevents, it makes sure that if there's a certain class of people, a certain ethnicity, that they have a voice in their local representation. So for example, I was actually looking at some stats. Right now in Forsyth County, about 80% of us are Caucasian. The remaining 20% predominantly lives in the south part of the county. Not all of them, but that's where a lot of the non-Caucasians live. And if we were to go to countywide, they would lose their percentage of it. Okay, the district they're announced in District 2, that 20% represents, I don't know, I'm just gonna pull them around the air, to say 40%. It dilutes it if we go to countywide, so we have to stay within our districts right now. So the feasibility of us going to countywide, nobody in the delegation, except for maybe you, wants to do that. And it's just, if we do, we'd have to go back anyway, and we just need to move forward, figure out a way to make this work. What we can do is add a countywide at-large chairman and maybe even a vice chairman, so that we still have our districts, but then we add a couple of at-large commissioners as well. So there's other things we can do, we just haven't
decided. They would be full-time?
That's a possibility, yeah. It's not in stone, it could be part-time, could be full-time.
And we're still looking. As a delegation, I told you, we're all working together, and it's really nice as a newbie. I can't tell you what it was like before I came on board, but I can tell you that we are all working very hard and very well together to do things right for Forsyth County. So we are, I don't know, kind of in luck stuff, but we are working really, really hard as a county delegation to make sure that we're bringing the right representation.
Thank you.
All the issues we talked to tonight, whether it was commissioner, by district, or at large, taxing and so forth, it all comes down, in my analysis, as accountability, transparency, and so forth. And I have two examples which to me are unacceptable with the laws in Georgia as they stand today. First, I wrote a letter to the Board of Education asking for an open records request. I wanted this information. I was trying to determine whether there was contract zoning going on in Forsyth County. Oh, of course not. But the contract zoning is illegal in Georgia. I wrote the Board of Education, have you received any donations from a builder or developer, blah, 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 and I'd like you to search these things. They came back the next day, that'll cost you $2,700. I went back to him, I said, could you give me a little bit more detail of the hours it takes to collect it? He says, well, no, I don't have to according to the law. I have to be reasonable.
And you know what you can do? You can request it just to read them. You don't have to pay for them right away.
Well, so how indiscriminate it is. And so they come back and say, well, now we consider it's $911.74 because I lowered the amount of searching they had to do. A friend of mine put in a submission to the Board of Education for a completely different subject, completely different information. It came to $911.74. Well, what do you know? So I filed a complaint with the secretary of whoever the department is,
They said, well, we can ask them to reconsider. We can't force them to account how they arrived at $911. Unacceptable. The other issue, a commissioner, a commissioner would recuse himself or herself from voting, but they remain in the room and in the discussion. According to Georgia law, that's illegal, but there is no enforcement of that. It's relying on the citizens to report these people. There should be fines, jail time, to make sure our elected officials on the local, state basis are held accountable and transparent, and when they do recuse themselves or when they quote on an open records request, it is true, honest, transparent, and they have to prove it. And we don't have that in Georgia. So I would like to see someone with the bandwidth, and I think someone said earlier, kahunas, to stand up in the Gold Dome and say, we're number 50 in America. What are we going to do to get our trust back from our citizens?
You know what we can do? Let's go do the open records request, tell them to pile it up, and we'll pick and choose what we want.
Well, we could do that, but the issue is
you don't have to pay for anything.
We need backup. You really do. In the sense of they won't give me, like the Board of Education, we will not produce one thing until you pay.
They tried that with me before, and what they gave me was blank sheets of paper. So then I went back in and I said, I want to look at everything before I buy it. You have to look at it before you buy it.
The Board of Education?
Anyway, the key is we need
legislation to let these people know that work for us, we pay for them, that they will abide by the law.
Okay, we are almost out of time.
That's why I wanted to get that one.
We have to clear our room because we have a contract we have to abide by. Anything real quick you want to say in a few minutes in closing that we didn't touch on or just?
I just really want to thank you guys for showing up on a rainy Monday night to listen to us drone home. And I really am very excited about this opportunity. I tell you all, I'm very nervous about it. The first time that I cast a vote and I get to push one of those yellow or red buttons, it's going to be quite exciting for me. I'm just thrilled to have this opportunity. Never dreamed I would be there. And I just want to thank everyone here. If you're in the 24th district, thank you for voting for me. If you're in the 24th district and you didn't vote for me, why not? But we will be, both of us will be on the ballot again come May because that will be the primary. And please stay in touch with us. Please talk with us. When you disagree with us, disagree with us. And when you agree with us, agree with us. But thank you so much for being here tonight.
Thank you, Sheri.
Thank you guys for coming out here. And for all of you that supported me as well a couple years ago, thank you. Also, one of the promises that I made during that campaign was to be accessible. And I want to extend that out to you guys as well. I've tried to be very accessible. If you email me, call me, whatnot, to get back with you. And Bob, if you want to come sit down one day, we can go over some legislation that you'd like to see passed. I'm completely open to that.
I might be able to pull something out of my file.
Again, thank you all for coming out. It was a pleasure.
You're going to have a lot more of this. I'm sure you're getting pulled already with the session getting ready to start. One thing to remember, people talk about, that somebody said this is a democracy. Somebody was really quick to point out it's not a democracy, it's a representative republic, which means that we don't vote on all the issues. We hear where they stand on issues, and we say, I think this guy would make a good senator, I'm going to vote for him. And then we have to trust him to do what we hold him accountable. And that's why we're here. If you have one quick thing, yes? Oh, yeah. Anybody gets a flag? If you want to come, anything else, come on up here. I'll be here. They'll be here probably for a few minutes. If you have a chair and you want to take it and put it over there, there'll be someone helping you do it. That would help greatly to clear the room. Thank you, and I hope we're not meeting next month, are we?
No
meeting until January.
Good to see you. Here's
CJ Alex, right?
Yes.
Yes.